hier relevant. Dabei tritt, so meine These, Sokrates als Visionär. Wenden wir uns also zuerst der Sphäre der als Paradies geschilderten wahren Erde zu. Kurz bevor Sokrates diesen Mythos erzählt, spricht er davon, dass die Seele, die rein und maßvoll gelebt hat und Götter als Führer erhalten hat, über den ihr jeweils zukommenden Ort bewohnt. Im Mythos nun wird er konkreter. Über dem tief unten in der Erde liegenden Tartaros und den unterirdischen Flusslandschaften liegen höhere, beziehungsweise auf oder über der Kugelerde zu lokalisierende Bereiche. Die eigentliche Erde, so heißt es, liegt rein im reinen Himmelsraum, in dem die Sterne sind, den die meisten, die sich damit beschäftigen, Äther nennen. Oder wer von oben auf die Erde blickt, sagt Sokrates, wird erkennen, jener ist der wahre Himmel und das wahre Licht und die gleichsam wahre Erde, etwa 109 E und so weiter. Wahrheit und Reinheit charakterisieren diese Sphäre. Dann beschreibt Sokrates detaillierter die wahre Erde aus der Vogelperspektive, ihre prächtige Farbenvielfalt, Schönheit der Natur, Glätte und Luzidität der Gesteine und Edelmetalle, erweist sich als ein Schauspiel für selige Beschauer, Theama, Eudaimonon, Theaton, dessen Abglanz sogar noch in unseren Höhlen sichtbar sei. Die Menschen wohnen dort im Aer, zum Teil auf Inseln. Sie atmen Äther, das Klima ist ganzjährig günstig, die Menschen werden nicht krank oder hinfällig und sie leben länger. Es gibt dort heilige Haine und Tempel, in denen wirklich die Götter wohnen. Menschen und Götter verkehren mittels Stimmen, Wahrsagung, Erscheinungen miteinander. Sonne, Mond und Sterne können von dort in ihrer reinen Form erblickt werden. Hier also herrscht umfassende Eudaimonia, nicht zuletzt, wie ich meine, eine Folge der Gestirnsbetrachtung. Ich komme darauf noch zu sprechen. Wer lebt nun in dieser Sphäre auf der wahren Erde? Es sind verstorbene Menschen, die beim Gericht für ihr gutes Leben belohnt wurden, die fromm, Hosioi waren. Diese Menschen haben dort eine Art Körper. Sie leben lange, aber sie bleiben nicht auf ewig dort. An dieser Stelle deutet Sokrates an, dass dagegen diejenigen, die sich durch Philosophie hinreichend gereinigt haben, gänzlich ohne Körper für die Folgezeit leben und zu noch schöneren Wohnungen gelangen. Weitere Details spart er aus. Diese Wohnungen, so meint er, wären nicht leicht beschreibbar und jetzt reiche die Zeit nicht. Wo wir uns nun diesen Ort für die Philosophen vorzustellen haben, wird allein im Phaidon angedeutet. Im Gorgias gelangen die besonders guten Seelen zu den Inseln der Seligen, bleiben also im Raum des etablierten Mythos, wie sie etwa Homer, Hesiod oder Pindar beschrieben hatten. In der Politeia gelangen die guten Menschen in den Himmel, der nur als oberhalb des Daimonios Topos kenntlich wird. Die Guten kommen rein aus diesem Himmel zurück. Wenn Sokrates also allein hier im Phaidon auf die neue Sphäre für die Philosophen verweist, muss diese, so meine ich, in diesem Dialog von besonderer Bedeutung sein. Bereits an weiteren Stellen im früheren Gespräch mit Kebes kommt Sokrates auf eben diesen jenseitigen Bereich der Philosophen zu sprechen. Er beschreibt diesen als Beltistos Topos, der den Eudaimonestatoi vorbehalten bleibe. Damit macht er klar, dass es auch unter den Glücklichen graduelle Unterschiede gebe. Das nun nimmt vorweg, was Sokrates beim dritten Unsterblichkeitsbeweis sagt. Wie der Aufstieg der Seele in jenseitige Bereiche graduell erfolgt, so gibt es eine graduell hierarchische Stufung der Räume auch im Bereich der wahren Erde und darüber hinaus. Es kommt also dort zu einer Ausdifferenzierung unter den Glücklichen, von denen die Philosophen weiter oder höher auf jeden Fall in noch schönere Wohnungen gelangen. Das sind offenbar exklusive Räume, denn Sokrates macht klar, dass allein derjenige, der sich philosophisch betätigt hat und vollständig rein geworden ist, auch zu den Göttern Aistheon Genos gelangt. Wo müssen wir uns nun im Phaidon den jenseitigen Raum für die Philosophen vorstellen? der erkennbaren immanenten Erzähllogik und Erzählstrukturierung zufolge, nach der die Räume im Jenseits hierarchisch nach ihrer Wertigkeit angeordnet sind, ist der Bereich für die gänzlich Gereinigten noch höher als der des Glücks auf der wahren Erde zu lokalisieren und damit also im Bereich des Äthers, also im Himmel, zu denken. Ich möchte das kurz begründen. Die glücklichen Menschen auf der wahren Erde kommunizieren zwar mit Göttern, die als nah gedacht sind und können sie wahrnehmen, aber wenn man genau hinsieht, verkehren sie mit diesen Göttern vor allem mittels bekannter ritueller Praktiken über Medien. Ich vermute, dass die hier gemeinten Götter denen der traditionellen griechischen Religion und Lebenswelt entsprechen dürften. Denn wenn diese Götter sinnlich wahrnehmbar sind, dann müssen sie in irgendeiner Weise als gestalthaft und damit letztlich anthropomorph gedacht sein. Auch das ist ein weiterer Hinweis darauf, dass hier noch nicht die höchste Stufe erreicht ist, dass die Götter auf dieser Ebene noch nicht das höchste Göttliche darstellen. Darüber hinaus sind in dieser Sphäre Sonne, Mond und Sterne offenbar wichtige Bezugspunkte für die Glücklichen auf der wahren Erde. Die Gestirne können von dort aus ja ungehindert und so wie sie wirklich sind, gesehen werden. Nicht zuletzt aus dieser Gestirnsbetrachtung resultiert eine offenbar noch größere Glückseligkeit. Es sind also räumlich wie hinsichtlich des Glücks auf der wahren Erde noch höhere Grade erkennbar. Diejenigen freilich, die in ihrer Annäherung an das Göttliche noch weiter gekommen sind, die Philosophen, unterscheiden sich von den anderen Glücklichen dadurch, dass ihnen die Trennung vom Körper, also die Katharsis, zu Lebzeiten in höherem Maße gelungen ist. Hier ist das Konzept vom Körper als Gefängnis verschmolzen mit dem vom Körper als Verunreinigung der Seele. Katharsis erweist sich somit als Schlüssel zum Verständnis. Bereits im Gespräch mit Kebes zuvor hatte Sokrates sein religiös basiertes Konzept von Philosophia als Reinigung beschrieben. Die hinreichende, Hikanos heißt es, die hinreichende Katharsis der Philosophen, also derer, die bereits zu Lebzeiten erfolgreich mittels der Tugenden und hier vor allem Phronesis, die Melete Thanatou betrieben hatten, besteht Sokrates zufolge aus der vollständigen Trennung von Seele und Körper. Der Philosoph darf im Jenseits völlig körperfrei in seliger Ruhe und Glück für die nach dem Tod folgende Zeit leben. Katharsis erweist sich Sokrates zufolge als rein ethischer und intellektueller Prozess, wenn man so will, als lebenslange, mühsame, seelische Ritualpraxis des Philosophen, die sich absetzt von der in Initiations- oder Reinigungsritualen propagierten Katharsis bzw. die diese intellektualisiert. Dazu kommt im Phaidon allerdings noch der räumliche Aspekt. Nach der Erzähllogik des Mythos dürfen wir nämlich annehmen, dass die Seele eines Philosophen, wie Sokrates ihn als Ideal schildert, da vom Körper erleichtert, noch weiter oben im Äther zu denken ist. Das wäre also in gewisser Analogie zu den alten mythischen Helden, die auf die Inseln der Seligen oder ins Elysium entrückt werden, die gewissermaßen philosophische, moderne Variante der Entrückung des neuen Helden, des Philosophen, in den Himmel oder, um es platonisch zu sagen, in die Gefilde des Noeton. Für diese Vorstellungen vom Kosmos als Jenseits und der Seele am Himmel lassen sich verschiedene Erklärungsbündel zusammenschnüren, die, wie bereits Walter Burkert beobachtet hat, allesamt letztlich auf der damals neuen astronomischen Einsicht in die Kugelgestalt der Erde beruhen. Somit waren weder ein traditioneller Hades noch die Inseln der Seligen am Rand der Erde länger zu verorten. Die wohl ältesten Belege dafür finden sich, also soweit ich das jetzt gefunden habe, in der attischen Tragödie, etwa in Sophokles' Trachinierinnen oder bei Euripides in den Hiketiden. Damit konvergiert auch die Grabinschrift der in der Schlacht von Potidaia gefallenen von 432 vor Christus mit ihrer dualistischen Vorstellung, dass die Seele nach oben in den Äther gehe, während der Körper von der Erde aufgenommen werde. Neben vorsokratischen Theorien des 5. Jahrhunderts, genauer der ionischen Physiologie, die letztlich Seele und Himmel in das Verhältnis von Makrokosmos und Mikrokosmos setzt, spielen auch eleusinische sowie zeitgenössische orphisch-pythagoreische Vorstellungen über Seele und Jenseits eine wichtige Rolle für Platon. Während im Ehrmythos der Politeia die Seelen nach dem Trunk aus Lethe wie Sterne ins Werden auf die Welt stürzen, lässt sich auch die Rückkehr der Seele an den Himmel bei Platon finden. nicht zuletzt im Timaios, wie die Zugehörigkeit jeder Seele zu einem Stern kenntlich. Die Sterne sind demnach Herkunftsort der menschlichen Seele, wohin sie nach dem Tod des Körpers zurückkehren. Auch in den Nomoi begegnet diese Vorstellung, wenn dem Athener zufolge die in jeglicher Tugend guten Seelen als Götter anzusehen sind, welche als Zoa beseelte Sterne den Himmel schmücken. Die stimulierende Rolle, die unter Platons Schülern etwa Eudoxos oder Herakleides Pontikos für derartige Konzeptionen zukommen dürfte, sei aus Zeitgründen hier ausgespart. Insgesamt wird aber deutlich, dass Platon seinen Sokrates hier aktuelle religiöse Vorstellungen des ausgehenden 5. und des frühen 4. Jahrhunderts aufgreifen lässt. Allerdings werden diese, der Aufstieg der Seele nach dem Tod an den Himmel, ihre Reintegration in den Kosmos, ihre astrale Unsterblichkeit, sowie die jenseitige Belohnung für ethische und intellektuelle Bemühungen offenbar erst von Platon miteinander verbunden. Sie bilden ins Philosophische transponiert die Voraussetzung für das von Sokrates im Phaidon-Mythos angedeutete Elysium der Philosophen, der Glücklichsten unter den Glücklichen. Im Folgenden, das ist mein zweiter Punkt, geht es darum, warum nur und gerade im Phaidon das jenseitige Schicksal der Seelen von Philosophen anklingt. Die Ausgangshypothese ist die, dass der Phaidon-Mythos mit Blick auf den ganzen Dialog eine neue Perspektive eröffnet. Es geht konkret um den Tod des Philosophen Sokrates, das unmittelbar nach dem Jenseitsmythos vom Erzähler des Dialogs Phaidon minutiös geschildert wird. Im vorangehenden Gespräch versuchte Sokrates, seine Freunde von der Unsterblichkeit der menschlichen Seele zu überzeugen, zuerst mittels argumentativ gestützter Beweisgänge, abschließend mit dem großen Jenseitsmythos, mit dem er das bisher Gesagte anhand seines psychozentrischen Universums, um David Sedley zu zitieren, illustrieren will. Philipp Karfik hat gezeigt, dass die mythologische Kosmoskonzeption des Phaidon nicht nur eine klare Korrespondenz der Räume mit den dort angesiedelten Seelen aufweist, sondern letztlich eine Visualisierung von Zuständen und Räumen der Seele nach dem Tod darstellt. Kosmologie und Psychologie sind hier im Moment der Erzählung des Sokrates geradezu identisch. Ich nenne das Psychotopologie. Der Jenseitsmythos im Phaidon beruht dabei auf der von Sokrates vorgenommenen Korrektur einer verbreiteten communis opinio. Während die Menschen glauben, auf der Erde zu leben, leben sie in Wirklichkeit in höhlenähnlichen Vertiefungen und in Höhlen unter der Erde. Die Anlehnung an Empedokles als Prätext ist bekannt, ebenso die Analogien zu Platons Höhlengleichnis in Politeia 7. Es ist aber, so meine These, erst diese von Sokrates markierte Korrektur und der damit einhergehende suggestive Perspektivenwechsel, es ist der Blick von oben auf die Erde, der die grundlegende Einsicht ermöglicht, dass oberhalb der Höhlen die wahre Erde liegt. Die hier beschriebene gleichsam extraterrestrische Kataskopie sowie die daraus resultierenden Einsichten über Räume, Menschen, Seelen, Vorgänge und Wege trägt deutliche Züge eines visionär vollzogenen Aktes, wie das aus Beschreibungen ekstatischer Jenseits- oder Transzendenzerfahrungen durchaus auch in philosophischer Literatur bekannt ist. Zu erwähnen ist hier natürlich Parmenides und Empedokles, natürlich auch das Höhlengleichnis Platons, aber auch die Jenseitsmythen Plutarchs. Bislang nicht beachtet wurde, von welchem Akteur diese Vision oder Ekstase im Phaidon-Mythos denn eigentlich vollzogen wird. Im Text Platons finden sich allerdings Andeutungen. Sokrates nennt zweimal einen bestimmten Mann ohne Namen, Tis, mit starker Natur, der diese visionäre Erdenschau von oben vollzieht und dabei Einsicht in die wahren Verhältnisse um den Kosmos und den Menschen, um das, was wahrhaft ist, gewinnt. Während die Glücklichen auf der wahren Erde den Blick nach oben auf die Gestirne richten, kann dieser Akteur eine kosmische Gesamtschau von oben herab vollziehen. Es handelt sich dabei vermutlich in Analogie zum anonymen Hauptakteur im Höhlengleichnis der Politeia auch hier um den platonischen Sokrates selbst, der zu dieser Schau oder Einsicht gelangt ist. Wie der Protophilosoph im Höhlengleichnis nach seiner Schau der wahren Welt außerhalb der Höhle wieder in diese hinabsteigt, um die Menschen dort über ihre grundlegenden Irrtümer aufzuklären, so berichtet der platonische Sokrates auch im Phaidon von einer solchen Schau im Jenseits, hier freilich fokussiert auf das Schicksal der unsterblichen Seele. Die im Phaidon nun beschriebene Schau der Erde und des Jenseits ermöglicht, so Sokrates explizit, eine große Hoffnung, Megale Epis. Das Wagnis sei schön Und daher sei die gleichsam therapeutische Autosuggestion, das Ep-Ardein, durch solche Mythen auch für ihn wichtig. Folgende Beobachtung halte ich für wichtig. Platon verleiht hier seinem Sokrates etliche Züge der in der griechischen Welt lange bekannten Iatromantes, als deren prominenteste Beispiele etwa Epimenides, Empedokles oder Pythagoras bekannt sind. Ihre Befähigung zu Ekstasen, Seelen oder Himmelsreisen ist, den antiken Zeugnissen zufolge, immer mit medizinisch heilenden, kathartischen und mantischen Kompetenzen verbunden. Auch wenn Sokrates im Phaidon nicht als Iatromantes im engeren Sinne stilisiert ist, führt er doch Semantiken und Praktiken von Heilung, Katharsis und Mantik auch außerhalb des Jenseitsmythos wiederholt im Munde. Die Übertragung ursprünglich religiöser, sogar ekstatischer Charakteristika auf die Person und die Schilderung des Sokrates macht diesen somit als Visionär des Jenseits kenntlich. Wichtig erscheint mir hier die von Sokrates betonte Rückbindung an Apollon zu sein, etwa wenn er seine Mantikä explizit auf diesen Gott zurückführt. Platon lässt seinen Sokrates hier also, ähnlich wie Homer seinen Odysseus, aus dem Jenseits berichten und stilisiert ihn in Anlehnung an die Helden mythischer Katabaseis, etwa Theseus oder auch Herakles. Zugleich lässt er ihn gleichsam nach dem Modell religiöser Ekstatiker eine Vision beschreiben. Aber er macht, wie das Gespräch mit den Freunden zeigt, seinen Sokrates unmissverständlich zu einer philosophisch glaubwürdigen Autoritätsgestalt in Sachen Jenseits. Der Visionär Sokrates stellt am Ende nämlich einen klaren Bezug zwischen sich und dem Mythos her. Diesen macht er zum Bild seiner Hoffnung, dass seine Seele im Jenseits, entsprechend seinen Anstrengungen um Arete zu Lebzeiten, in die ihr angemessene Sphäre gelangt, auch wenn der Mythos natürlich nicht wortwörtlich zu nehmen sei. Im letzten und dritten Schritt möchte ich anhand weiterer Passagen aus dem Phaidon zeigen, dass Sokrates hier tatsächlich als Kandidat für den noch schöneren Bereich der Glückseligkeit über der wahren Erde gelten muss. Das bestätigt nämlich der Erzähler und Augenzeuge Phaidon bereits im Rahmengespräch mit Echekrates. Denn er beschreibt Sokrates dort bereits an seinem letzten Lebenstag als glücklich Eudaimon, was aus seinem Verhalten sowie seinen Worten zu Lebzeiten sowie durch sein exemplarisch tapferes Sterben begründet wird. Phaidon vertraut darauf, dass Sokrates nicht anoiteias moiras in den Hades geht und dass es ihm dort gut geht, eipatis popote kai allos, wie es heißt. Phaidons Optimismus über das Wohlergehen der Seele des Sokrates im Hades bzw. im Jenseits beruht klar auf dessen Ausführungen im Mythos, den er ja selbst mitgehört hat. Sokrates selbst machte bereits deutlich, wo er sich im Jenseits sieht. Denn gegen Ende des letzten Gesprächs mit den Freunden sagte er, er werde nun eis makaron daetinas eudaimonias weggehen und lässt damit schon einen gewissen Optimismus anklingen, in die den Philosophen vorbehaltenen höheren Sphären zu kommen. Der Erzähler Phaidon hat also den von Sokrates erzählten Mythos sowie die Raumbeschreibung für die reinen Frommen und die Philosophen auf der wahren Erde ernst genommen und ihn auf Sokrates selbst übertragen, wenn er an dessen Wohlergehen im Jenseits fest glaubt. Damit projiziert er den Philosophen Sokrates bzw. dessen unsterbliche Seele mindestens in den Raum der Glücklichen auf der wahren Erde, vielleicht sogar in den von Sokrates selbst visionär geschilderten Raum der Wahrheit und des Glücks am Himmel. Insgesamt steht damit der Zusammenhang zwischen Rahmengespräch und Jenseitsmythos außer Frage. Die Rahmenbemerkungen des Erzählers Phaidon bekräftigen all die Vorstellungen, die der Philosoph und Visionär Sokrates als Hoffnung für das Jenseits auch selbst beschrieben hatte. Am Erzähler also, als primärem Publikum, zeigt sich also die eindrückliche Wirkung der Worte des Sokrates. Die Sonderstellung der Philosophen im Phaidon und der ihnen eigenen Sphäre im Jenseits, auf die Sokrates im Mythos selbst verwiesen hatte, ist natürlich dem Anliegen des Autors Platon geschuldet. Denn dieser stellt seinen sterbenden Sokrates als philosophisches Paradigma und als Visionär des Jenseits dar. Vor dem Hintergrund der im Mythos geschilderten Psychotopologie wird verständlich, dass der glückliche Sokrates die Jenseitshoffnung des Philosophen glaubwürdig machen soll, Die Entrückung des Philosophen, des neuen Helden, hat also hier, wie ich meine, bereits begonnen. Ich danke Ihnen für Ihre Aufmerksamkeit.
Vielen Dank, Auke, für die Zeitlichkeit. Wirklich 20 Minuten. Wir haben also ungefähr 10 Minuten für die Diskussion. Bitte Wortmeldungen. Herr Ferber.
Mit Mikrofon, bitte.
Herzlichen Dank für diesen ausgezeichneten Vortrag. Ich hätte viele Fragen, nur eine würde mich besonders interessieren. Am Ende der Apologie gibt es ja auch einen Jenseitsmythos in Anführungszeichen. Das Glück, das Amechanon, besteht darin in intellektueller Aktivität, nämlich Gespräche zu führen mit Odysseus, Sisyphus und anderen, welche gerecht gewesen sind. Im Phaidon dagegen haben wir es mit Schauen zu tun. Ja. Also, wie erklären Sie sich diesen Übergang von einer eher diskursiven intellektuellen Tätigkeit zu einer kontemplativen, eben im Phaidon?
Ja, vielen Dank für Ihre Frage. Also ich glaube, dass im Phaidon beides vorhanden ist. Ich glaube, dass wir vorher bei den sogenannten argumentativ gestützten Beweisgängen, die Sokrates über die Unsterblichkeit der Seele versucht, dass wir da eher diskursive Momente haben. Und am Schluss im Mythos kommt dann eben diese Überhöhung durch die Schau. Und da kommen dann eben auch diese räumlichen Differenzierungen mit dazu, auf die es mir hier ankam. Also ich denke eigentlich, dass im Phaidon beides drin ist, während in anderen Dialogen eben nur einzelne Facetten dieses großen Gesamtbildes, das wir hier haben, enthalten sind.
Andere Frage? González, Francisco.
Ist das so laut? ich habe eine dumme Frage. Sie sagen, dass der Mythos nicht wortwörtlich zu nehmen sei. Meine Frage ist, wie dann ist es zu nehmen? Sie sprechen von einer Psychotopologie. Dann können wir sagen, dass der Topos ist nur ein Metapher für die Psyche.
Vielen Dank. Nein, also ich glaube, also Sokrates sagt, dass der Mythos nicht wortwörtlich zu nehmen ist, nicht ich. Ich habe ihn relativ wörtlich genommen, weil ich finde, dass Sokrates auch große Mühe drauf verwendet, diesen Mythos darzustellen. Also wenn man nur an das unterirdische Flusssystem denkt, dass da sehr, sehr detailliert beschrieben wird. Also ich glaube, er nimmt ihn auch wörtlicher, als er tut. Das ist das eine. Zum anderen sind das natürlich metaphorische Raumbilder, also die nicht natürlich wirklich zu lokalisieren sind, aber sie sind doch in einer gewissen Weise aussagekräftig und doch auch nachvollziehbar, eben durch die Anbindung noch der Sphären unterhalb von Sonne, Mond und Sternen und die darüber angedeuteten Sphären. Also ich glaube, man kann das ganz gut zur Deckung bringen.
Wenn keine andere Frage. Es gibt eine andere Frage von Philipp Garfig.
Vielen Dank für den schönen Vortrag. Es gibt die Frage, wer das gesehen hat, also wer das Sokrates erzählt hat. Es gibt diesen Nachdruck bei Sokrates, wo er sagt, ich ließ mich überzeugen von jemandem. Also dieser Überzeugungsmoment, was sollen wir damit anfangen? Und zusätzlich dazu gibt es da doch nicht eine Verbindung mit den ganzen Mythen, die von Anfang an erzählt worden sind. Also der Mythos über die wahren Philosophen und dann der Palaios-Mythos mit dem Argument aus den Gegensätzen.
Ja, vielen Dank. Du spielst natürlich auf dieses Hypotenos Pepeismai ein, was 2-3 Mal kommt. Und dann kommt immer wieder dieser Tis, von dem er das gehört haben will und von dem er überzeugt worden ist. Ich bin geneigt, es als Rhetorik zu nehmen, dass das eigene Erfahrungen sind oder eigene Einsichten sind, die Sokrates hier formuliert. Und ich glaube, dass auch diese Jenseitsberichte, die, glaube ich, dann doch abzusetzen sind von den anderen Mythen, die er erzählt bekommt und die er referiert, zu betrachten sind. Also ich denke auch, dass im Höhlengleichnis der Politeia ja auch dieser Tis sehr deutlich als Sokrates ab einem gewissen Punkt zu identifizieren ist. Und ich würde meinen, man kann diese Erklärungsfolie auch hier anwenden. Man muss nicht, aber man kann. Und dann kann man sich natürlich fragen, wo hat Sokrates diese Einsichten her? Und dann könnte man im Grunde, wenn man will, mit einer doch stark gesteigerten Anamnesis argumentieren, so wie sie auch vorher im Dialog schon vorkam. Also ich würde meinen, man kann diese Erklärung versuchen.
Ja, theoretisch haben wir noch 2 oder 3 Minuten, wenn keine, ja, es gibt eine, ja, bitteschön.
Also ich möchte mich entschuldigen, falls ich das einfach nicht mitbekommen habe. Aber was passiert mit den schlechten Seelen? Sind die auch in der Oberwelt? Und wie wäre das zu vereinbaren mit dem Ehrmythos natürlich dann? Und wenn man dann Burkhard ernst nimmt mit dem, dass eben die wissenschaftliche Revolution dazu beigetragen hat, dass man keine Unterwelt mehr in der Erde verorten konnte, wie geht das dann zusammen? Also wo sind die schlechten Seelen?
Ja, Sie haben natürlich völlig recht, die habe ich aber weggelassen heute. Ich habe mich heute ausschließlich auf die Guten konzentriert und da auch nur auf die Besten, also die Philosophen. Sie haben völlig recht, von den Schlechten ist natürlich weiter vorne im Mythos die Rede. Die verbleiben, also die kommen zu diesem Jenseitsgericht und die so mittelmäßig gelebt haben, die kommen nach einer gewissen Zeit der Läuterung dann wieder ins Leben zurück und die ganz Schlechten müssen noch weiter runter in diesen Tartarus, in dieses fürchterliche, wogende Flusssystem und werden dann ab einem gewissen Punkt ganz spät wieder ausgespuckt. Das ist grauslich, aber ich glaube, das schließt nicht aus, dass die Erde jetzt Kugelgestalt hat, sondern wir sind im Grunde in dieser Kugel im Bauch und ganz unten, ja, also um es bildlich zu sagen. Und wo wir jetzt waren, wir waren jetzt im Grunde bei der Erdkugel gewissermaßen, die extraterrestrisch hier geschildert wird und da ganz oben beziehungsweise drüber Richtung Aether. Mhm.
Dankeschön. Ich hätte gerne eine Frage, aber wegen der Zeit, ich muss leider ausgeben. Also danke, Himmi. The second speaker is Professor Harold Tarrant of the University, Emeritus Professor of Classics and University of Newcastle, Australia. Harold Tarrant is author of some very important books, monographies on Plato's, on Platonic tradition. I would like to mention only Skepticism or Platonism, Plato's First Interpreters, and Thrasylian Platonism. Harold Tarrant will speak about argument from similarity or Socrates' inspired vision, part one.
Is it possible to show a PowerPoint easily enough? I mean, I could simply swap places with you, can I? That might be the easiest thing. Does it need to be logged on again? Can you? It doesn't matter if you work on it. Oh, right, okay. So I can simply open my PowerPoint. I just want to open a PowerPoint from my. This one? Yep. Can we find a file for the Virginia right here? Is it possible?
Do a search.
At the top. I don't use these blasted silly things. That's the trouble. Magnificent. Okay. And it will be where is that? And I want to go from the beginning in can we get it up on the full screen? Sorry. I can only ever use a magnifier. Ah, wonderful. Sorry about that. The argument from similarity is not well regarded as an argument. Even in antiquity, Damasius was able to affirm of it that the older commentators have not been able to defend its validity, nor to parry the attacks launched against it from the side of the other schools. I have no intentions of suggesting that this is not an argument at all. Am I really that? Yeah, okay. Though I think that we should follow ancient practice by seeing it as a logos rather than an apodeixis. What I aim to do is to suggest that it should not really be considered a proof of immortality of the soul, and at the same time that it plays a role that is much richer than can simply be attributed to an argument. If we look back to the ancient commentators on the Phaedo, we learn that Iamblichus had found in the dialogue several independent arguments for the immortality of the soul. The argument from similarity would count as the third of these. Olympiodorus simply uses the word logos for argument, even when explaining the view of Iamblichus. Damasius, too, uses logos, though when speaking specifically of Iamblichus's thesis, he employs the verb apodeixai. However, Neoplatonists discovered independent arguments and proofs where we should not, as can be seen from the fact that Olympiodorus himself detects no fewer than 6 epihereimata for the refutation of Callicles in the Gorgias between 492d and 499b, the first 4 of which would not even look like arguments to us. But the surviving commentaries are much less ambitious for the reasoned content of this passage than Iamblichus had been, and correctly so, in my view. What I wish to argue is that the primary purpose of the passage is not to provide an additional formal argument by which the conclusion that the soul is immortal should be reached. Rather, that purpose is to begin to establish a kind of two-level picture of the environment in which the soul must move, placing the soul itself in a liminal position, albeit with greater affinity to one of those levels than to the other. The picture will finally be completed in the description of the true earth and the soul's journey within it that follows the final argument. I hasten to add that in its final form, this is not a two-world vision, but describes a single coherent world with parts that combine to form a dynamic system, a faculty that supplies a kind of picture to supplement a written logos is well known from the Philebus, but I prefer to look at the issue in terms of the Phaedo itself. The wider passage, 77d to 84b, contains much that is not argument and many hints that it's intended to introduce a myth-like vision that follows at 107 to 115. It begins with the needs of the gathering to find some epodos to charm away their childlike fears. And though Socrates does not directly affirm that this is what he is doing, One, he ought to be trying to supply what the inner child needs at this point. Two, he introduced the argument from similarity to counter the childish fear of the soul's dispersal at 78b. And three, he concludes the argument with a claim that the philosopher in particular should have no such fears. The inner child needs something to provide the security to believe what reason is telling us. But the text makes it plain that the incantation required is something to be repeated daily until the childish fear has been purged away, thus presumably differing from ordinary logical proofs that are expected to achieve their goal by convincing the interlocutor on the spot, being addressed, of course, to their rational faculty as opposed to any child within. Okay. Now, if we are entitled to view the argument from similarity as offering the kind of incantation that is required, then a second difference from Socrates' preferred style of argument is suggested by the Meno, an important dialogue given that the Phaedo seems already to have alluded to it at 73a to b. That dialogue had insisted on the priority of settling what a thing is over the question of what sort it is. The argument from similarity is introduced as an investigation of what sort of thing is liable to disperse, what sort is not, and which of the two sorts the soul resembles. In other words, it is asking whether the soul is such as to be dispersed prior to settling what soul is, in much the same way as the Meno was asking whether the virtue was such as to be taught prior to agreeing what virtue is. It is an argument about the kind of thing the soul is and has all the vagueness that one might expect, with the soul failing to resemble completely either kind of reality with which Socrates compares it, and with it seemingly resembling more closely entities that might indeed be eternal, but are not the kind of entities whose mode of existence any of us would actually want to experience after death. Asking us what sort of thing the soul resembles would finally settle nothing, and the ultimate reaction of the most respected of the interlocutors will confirm that it has settled nothing. Simmias has seen that one could try to prove the immortality of a liar's attunement in much the same way, while Sebes, who has already conceded that even the slowest learner would agree that the soul resembles the ever-constant reality rather than the ever-changing bodily one, is concerned that this resemblance may entail no more than a very long-lasting nature. It simply has not given either of them cogent reasons for belief in its immortality. And at 88b, Sebes is requiring a proof that the soul is in its very nature destructible and imperishable. He's asking ti esti and not poion esti. If an episode in a dialogue is not represented internally as successfully proving a given thesis, and particularly if it does not proceed in the manner in which Plato thinks investigation should proceed, then there is every reason to question whether its purpose is to act as a proof at all. This episode is depicted rather as a means of countering the inner child, and the inner child is not susceptible to reason anyway. At this stage, Alican believes that what Plato is doing is employing the comparison as a dramatic vehicle to discuss the forms, if only to say something about them by way of introduction and orientation. I think that this is partially correct, but that Plato wants to convey his picture of the two-level world with the soul able to journey between levels, not just the one level of it. Of course, one of these levels of reality is familiar to all of us anyway, so that the divine and imperishable level is the one requiring emphasis. But the picture of the soul within this two-level world is also important. So, what Plato is doing is offering us part of his vision at this point, and this accords with the assumption that the child within is more responsive to pictures than to pure reasoning. Our Socratic epodos will require a vision underlying the words of his spell. countering the imaginings that preclude belief. The Epodos will, of course, use logoi as a therapy. And to judge from the comedies, these will be beautiful logoi in some sense, and beauty has the particular property of being accessible to our vision or our visual imagination. The visual imagination is intimately involved in this depiction of what the world of the soul is like. While one half of Socrates' two-part vision is not available to one's sight, he begins to map out what looks like an unfamiliar world beyond our world, which later turns out to be just another level of one single world at 108 to 113. The invisibility of that world is linked with the very imaginable picture of Hades, and prior to that comes the picture of the body only slowly decaying, especially when mummified in Egyptian fashion. Pictures of ghost-like beings trailing a bodily shadow emerge from 81b, and the notion of the soul unable to free itself being reincarnated as various animals appropriate to their past lives is again the kind of visual material to which the inner child may respond. The philosopher's fate cannot be painted so vividly, but what he understands is the way in which the soul can become locked in the body by its own volition. So he must try to squeeze out of it and to avoid the pleasures and pains that distort this view of what is real. The body is prison-like, 82e, a wider theme in the dialogue. Pleasures and pains are like nails that threaten to fix the soul in place. The alternating cycle of pleasures and pains is imagined visually as Penelope weaving and unweaving her mythical web. And at 84b, Socrates concludes his vision by taking us back to that childhood fear of the soul being scattered upon the winds. Visions are offered as antidotes for the misleading visions. Okay. Can we say that Socrates has used an argument to address the child within? In a sense, he has indeed done so, but the argument has been less important than the pictures that it conjures up. When Simmias and Sebes reveal what has been missing here, it is their rational faculties and not their inner child that speak. Not only had the argument itself been unsatisfactory, but the vision built upon it had not been securely derived from it. In between, however, Socrates reveals further reason for thinking that Plato has been consciously presenting Socrates as a visionary in this passage, and a visionary of a type that the Timaeus itself, 71 to 72, considers incompatible with somebody in the sane and rational mode. The person who breaks into prophetic mode is properly to be separated from the rational interpreter of the former's utterances. Socrates fears that he seems to be poorer in his gift of prophecy than Apollo's swans who break into their most beautiful song as they are just about to leave for Hades. Is it then the case that he has now been offering us a swan song during this passage and imparting at least the first part of a vision that will be completed later in his description of those other parts of the universe that embodied humans cannot know? Is it a first glimpse into this approaching world that Socrates will see more clearly later, perhaps in the myth? This will require a brief diversion. The hooper swan, Cygnus cygnus, that may be found wintering on coastal marshes around the Aegean, does have a pleasant sound, which is at its most musical in spring, as with most birds, when it heads for Arctic Europe. The composer Sibelius details the sound of 16 of these birds encountered in Finland in April 1915 during or at the end of their spring migration, describing their calls as somewhere between woodwind and brass. There we are, a little French to capture something a little bit more poetic, shall we say. Seigneur Dieu, quelle beauté! Le cri était du même type que celui des grues, rappelant les bois, le cri du cygne plus proche de la trompette, and in the end, legato aux trompettes. And Sibelius was inspired by these swans. They do actually have something that can be described as a song, which is important when you read some of the mistaken literature. Okay, note then the mythical swan song of the Hooper swan has behind it the real migration of the flying creature, a real migration that could easily be seen as flight to their death by those who experience a huge flock of overwintering birds for several months. Note their increased volume and urgency of their calls one day, and then observe that they have disappeared the following day. Such myths designed to explain the phenomena associated with bird migration are not uncommon. For those who knew or suspected the reality behind the myth, it could be explaining the emotions of a creature on its journey home, and since these birds were seen as sacred to Apollo, the Hyperborean migratory god who is also in charge of prophecy, these emotions were those of a visionary creature. That Socrates is like the swans and serves the same master is emphasized at 85b. Whether Plato knew or suspected that the swans that deserted Greece in the spring were flying north to return later, we cannot tell, but it is likely that he recognized the story of the swan, that it is about to die, as the kind of tale likely to be told to young children as an explanation of a departure that would otherwise be as unexplained as the late summer departures of the nightingale, swallow, and hoopoe, which also required a myth to which Socrates refers in the same context. The singing swans are a powerful symbol of transmigration regardless. The swan is a bird that sings at the end as opposed to the cock that crows at the beginning. The metaphorical swan will be repaid by the cockerel. And the close connection between even Asclepius and the swan may be seen in a picture on a coin from Clazomenae that I've just Googled up, following Beatrice Botti's nice paper, which gave me the idea. Sorry. Okay, and there we are. For all those reasons, one has to understand that the argument from similarity is adopted by Socrates not for the rational elimination of doubt, but as a tactic, for visually engaging and inspiring the child within us and introducing that small child within us to the prospects of an unseen world lying beyond their present experience. That tactic will be resumed once again when the rational adult has been appeased by the final argument for immortality. Indeed, one may note that at 108 to D2E, Socrates offers to describe not the exact truth about the expanded world that he envisages, but the idea of the world hoian pepesmai enai, that is, the sort of which it is. The myth will resume the account of what the world is like. And at the end there, I just offered you analysis. I'll just go very briefly over this. The single arrow there on the chart points to it to the a passage from 78 to 84 here, and the double arrow points to the two blocks of the mythical exposition that comes later. So the computer in this analysis is putting that one block closest to the two blocks there. And finally, the dendrogram here what you will find is that green cluster on the right that you see contains within it the two blocks of the myth-like speech at the end of the dialogue, and two blocks from the Phaedo from 78 until 84, all grouped together as the same kind of language. And the closest language in this analysis to it was Socrates' first speech and various parts of the Palinode from the most inspired speech that you could find in the Phaedrus. So there is this link of type between, there's a close link between the green cluster and the magenta cluster just to the right of it, indicating that they are in very roughly the same kind of speech. So what conclusions do we draw? Linguistically, the language of the passage 77 to 84 is closer to the final episode of the Socrates' myth-like vision at 107 to 115 than anything else in the Phaedo. And this is consistent with its being meant to convey the first stage, the 78 to 84 being meant to convey the first stage of Socrates' inspired vision of the soul's place in a two-tiered world. Thank you very much indeed.
Yes, question? Yeah, we have 10 minutes. Raphael Ferber.
I thank you very much for this interesting talk. Just one question. In the seventh letter, Plato says that the soul seeks the tiestin, the what, but what it gets is only the poion. Would this be a fine example of that?
Thanks very much. He does indeed. I hadn't actually thought about that before. I was trying to confine myself to what I consider to be the earlier part of Plato's writing career, but indeed it might be a fine example of that. Though I would believe that Plato tries to show not just what the soul is like in the final argument, but what it actually is. It is the bringer of life, and that sort of, and that general notion of the soul seems to run through quite a bit of the Phaedo, I think. But
Beatrice Bossi.
A very small question. I said this morning, I don't know if I said it because I skipped some parts, but I understood that in the Kamines, when Plato speaks about kaloi logoi, he means noble arguments. But you translate that as beautiful words, like Rosalind Weiss. So maybe you are not finding any difference between the enchantments in the comedies and the Phaedo. Can you say something about that?
Yes, I know. And I also know there's a slight inconsistency in the paper there, which I may indeed not have sorted out entirely. I think possibly the Timaeus goes a little too far for the Plato or the Phaedo. And of course, in Socrates, we have somebody who can both offer the rational argument and offer this visionary account of what things might be like in that world after death. And I think the two goes together, but I don't think you've actually got a proof of why the soul is like he says it is there in the visionary part. So I think that there is a separation, but not such a separation that the figure of Socrates cannot join the two together. And sorry to have mentioned you in vain in my paper, but you really did give me that funny little idea.
We have time for another question. Yes.
Thank you. I really liked your idea of a vision, but the problem with a vision is how does one displace it if you think it's misguided or incorrect? It seems that with argumentation, we might lay down at least some criteria from which to change from one view to another, but this idea of a vision, it seems like we have very little to appeal with. You know, I think that Kibbeus and Simmias give us, we might call them counter visions, counter analogies to Socrates' own, and he's able to answer them.
Thanks. That's a most important question, actually. Later Platonists would say, I believe, that this kind of diction is appealing to something within us that is hidden, but does have cognitive roots. In other words, it's appealing to that same internal knowledge that the theory of recollection is supposed to appeal to. I'm not sure that that's a very satisfying answer, but I think that Plato, working with myths in the Greek tradition, knew very well that there was something that people somehow responded to in myth, and that it was something that couldn't be denied. Now, I'd call it something deeply rooted in their culture. Plato might have regarded it as something deeply rooted in the recesses of their minds. Okay?
Okay, thank you very much. Are you remain or don't? Yeah.
Having you sniff, you see? Yes.
My class. Okay, we go to the third speaker. It's Professor Oscar Velasquez. Has been professor of ancient philosophy and of medieval philosophy in the University of Chile in Santiago. He has published books on Plato, Republic, Symposium, Timaeus, Alcibiades, Aristophanes, Clothes, Horace, Ars Poetica, etc. Oscar Velasquez will speak about En Philosophia, proposal about the methodological disposition of the Phaedo. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Franco. I will ask for pardon for my English. The scene is actually set out when Socrates is loosened from his chains on the day of his death. I guess there is here a prolepsis or anticipation of two main themes. The fact that the Phaedo is the second most comprehensive apology of Socrates written by Plato, and that the philosophical subject about the soul and his intelligible capacities are connected with the Republic's cave. Besides, in Phaedo, Socrates was just now being freed from ties and of arti lelumenon, and starts to comment about the consequences of his leg due to the bond. In the Republic,
there is the starting point of the prisoners' liberation, and the Phaedo, it is the beginning of his death. Men are from childhood in bonds, while the message of Socrates insists in a soul being released from his body as from fetters. Now, when Simmias asks Socrates to express and not to keep to himself that thought, since this will become a blessing for them and a defense for himself, the dialogue seems to gain a new impulse. The entourage of friends become judges, and Socrates turns his words into an apology. It seems reasonable to him that a man who has really spent his life in philosophy may feel confident when he is about to die. In this phrase, aner tonti en philosophia diatripsa ton bion, the core of his defense is manifestly revealed. For those faithful friends, the way to participate in that life is being next to Socrates, para ton Socrate. Actually, the verbal from diatripsas reveals that unique attitude of the philosopher Socrates, namely his dialogic, personal, and constant compromise with the circles of friends' disciples. The Socrates portrayed here is more reminiscent of a scholar of Plato's Academy. So the dialogue leads to an apologia pro vita sua, since Socrates has spent an entire life philosophizing and sharing his time in philosophia with those next to Socrates. It is a defense of philosophical life in the way the master used to practice it. In the Phaedo, philosophical life and Socrates are almost synonymous. So philosophy becomes practical wisdom, phronesis, that is to say, prudence in government of the proper affairs throughout life. Just like death is deliverance, a sort of liberation, apalagen, there is a pragma, an act that consists in committing oneself to philosophy. These are the two consequent aspects of a life in accordance with phronesis. Thus, philosophy consists in this separation, and apolion is to get soul free in order to set forth the search for truth. This means that the activity of philosophy consists in turning towards the soul, pros sigen tetrapsai. This is a turning point in the path towards truth and wisdom. In fact, a shift towards the inner self followed by a search for reality, zedese. Indeed, if we compare this process in the Phaedo with the allegory of the cave, we will find useful clarifications, since those forms at the exit of the cavern are here intelligibly in the soul, something like noeton de kai philosophia aireton. On the other side, the prisoner of the cave, when near in reality, having turned towards more real things, pros malon onta tetramenos, would see more truly. He will approach
those real objects of knowledge by thought, that is, te dianoia chromenos. Now, in both cases, there is an intentional jaya, but in the Phaedo is more clearly defined towards the inner self. This change of directions means here the process of an entire life, and those forms of republic lie intelligibly in the soul, namely in thought itself, aute te dianoia. For the soul to apprehend truth, then a change of route is required to undertake a methodical path. I call this philosophical procedure the inner cave, which really which recalls the investigation of the Smikra Grammata of Republic. There the Meizo Grammata replace the smaller ones in the process of searching for justice in the city. Here in the Phaedo, Socrates deals with the small ones, taking his search of truth into his own cave by isolating the soul. It is the inner turn. We will see that it is a type of shortcut. Here, this cave is the method of the inner search for being and truth. It is a path without dialectics in the strict sense of the Republic, since this type of philosophical method is absent in our dialogue. I mean dialectics as a dialectique method, Republic, a kind of objective search for truth with the aid of Paideia. But all the same, in the Phaedo, it is about the searching of the truth. And truth consists here in those inner intelligible objects as beauty, good, or just itself. In our dialogue, truth is deployed within the self, and it begins with an act of liberation of ties. The fetters are symbolized here by the body. The right itself, it is a kind of thing that can now be accessed, te dianoia. It is clear that what it is at stake is ten tes phroneseos ktesin, the acquisition of wisdom, because it is those entities themselves that are the material that shapes phronesis in us. Those entities are the very objects of thought. Thanks to dianoia, they are known, while the access to the inner things is through the body. What dianoia does is dianoethenai. This means through which the soul thinks, the objects of thought proper. Now, the act of recollection of soul, its inner turn, is put into play by the act of deliverance by means of dianoia. This is an act of requiemment of the mind. We may say, then, that philosophy in us consists in the acquisition of phronesis. Then, there are three converging events. A methodical isolation whereby the soul is prepared to escape. This means separation. In other words, deliverance of the soul. Man, having been isolated from the body, is auten kathauten. It is the inner track of soul towards truth. the inner. B, a state of deliverance, that is, of isolation of the mind itself. Autete dianoia, whereby man tracks down the realities that are pure and simple by means of a pure and simple mind. C, a state of separation of the very entities, not of the man, but of the entities, which are thus the objects of the mind, namely each pure being by itself. Auto kathauto elikrines hekaston. That explains why the anoia, the mind as intellect in action, acts as the axis of all these three themselves and converge in a soul itself. This methodical withdrawal for the acquisition of truth is a type of rehearsal of death, the final deliverance. All three merge finally in the soul when the philosopher undertakes the hunting of beings. When this happens to be in a man, life, we can recognize those who have been true philosophers. Because when A and B are attained, the soul can understand the objects of mind itself. In other words, it is able to attain C. So A and B correspond to the activities of the true philosopher, and C to the object of thought itself. Thus, en philosophia comprises the three. That being so, namely, when we will be nearest to see with the mind, to Eidenai, we will live en philosophia. This method is called by Socrates atrapostis, a type of shortcut. This is because the methodical progress is here an inner experience, namely a walk of life. It is not properly the same as in Republic, where Plato refers to the dialectical method as a way of inquiry, methods odo. This method seems here the acquisition of a systematic course of action, the way of engaging in spending one's own life philosophizing. In Phaedo, Socrates has spent his life in philosophia. Therefore, he has been in a process of deliverance throughout his life by means of the liberation of body and his continuing chase of the true being. In this sense, en philosophia epitomizes the steady progress of soul in the acquisition of wisdom. How is it the time? Is it okay? So? 3 minutes, okay. Yeah. It's all alive. Living in philosophy is returning to an inner path to liberation and a persevering attitude of searching the real. Socrates has given himself time to contemplate truth. Withdrawal from into oneself is rather connected with catharsis, with horizein, with synageidesai, etc. This is a methodological way of reaching truth by means of the activity of thought in the soul. The body's fetters may be compared with Republic 7, like Afrosyne, thoughtlessness, also with Republic 7, Fluaria, Phaedo, with Republic 7, et the bigger letters of justice in Republic 2 might echo the small ones I would say, of liberation in fato. So I want to call oi philosophuntes orthos phaedos inner path. The last paragraph. This path is the shortcut, atrapos tis. But this is also the journey, poreia, of the myth of the destiny of souls and of Socrates' final travel to the Hades. Those poreiai reappear in the Republic precisely to indicate the dialectic way, or to point out the happy path of the journey-wise man's soul to heaven or to this life. The inner sense of all this, I surmise, is to show the meaning of philosophical life as a continuous progress towards wisdom and virtue. To make this journey, we ought to travel through a path that is to say, philosophically speaking, by means of a methodological disposition. From this perspective, Phaedo is a dialogue about philosophy and how to live in philosophia.
Question number one, Tommy.
Thank you very much for a wonderful talk. Well, I have one question. You often use inner, to the inside. Well, of course, Socrates discussed the soul itself and its contemplative truth. But I wonder if we can say that is a truth inside. Because, you know, Neoplatonists like Plotinus and Augustine, they emphasize, you know, the truth we have to be inside. But in the Phaedo, as far as I see, I'm a bit suspicious about, you know, your claim that we need to come inside. So could you give us some more evidence?
Thank you, Professor Noboru. I would like to say that, in fact, those ideal forms are in the Phaedo inside the man. So that is the reason why I thought the course of the cave is not outside, but it is inside. It's a shortcut because the final ideas you find are not the ideas outside the cave that are a type of objective realities in a way, yeah? But you find them in an intelligible way. So I think in that sense, Plotinus was rightly interpreting the Phaedo, I think. Huh? I suppose that this is in a way more modern, I would say. One of the reasons why Plato, I think, Plato is still now a great philosopher for all the modernity and contemporaneity, is because of the Phaedo, and interpreted as humbly I suppose to be.
Araújo.
Thank you for your paper. I just want to ask about this living in philosophy and the emphasis you gave in internal isolation, internal meditation, contemplation. And the scene of the Phaedo is this scene of a group of people in dialogue, engaging themselves in dialogue. So Would you say that living in philosophy is also a communitarian project? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carolina. I think I am completely in accordance with you, because I think en filosofía, as I tried to say here also, is in a way connected with para ton Socrate. Para ton Socrate. So what does it mean? That there is a group of people just philosophizing with him. And I remember your paper about political thing, and I was very, very happy to hear you and to understand better what I have tried to say here, that here we can see a Plato who is not only a personal insider philosopher, but is also a philosopher who likes to be para other peoples. Huh? And those are not all, as you said, but it's a group that can follow him, and they are happy to be near him. So I think it's perfectly what you have said about this.
Thank you. We can go to the last speaker. Thank you very much, Professor Velasquez. Thank you very much. Francisco Gonzalez, who is professor of philosophy in the University of Ottawa. His publication include the Dialectic and Dialogue, Plato's Practice of Philosophical Inquiry, Plato and Heidegger, A Question of Dialogue, and Francisco Gonzalez is editor of the famous book, The Third Way, A New Directions in Platonic Studies. I would like to mention a very important essay of Francisco Gonzalez, New Propositional Talk in Plato, is very original and innovative contribution published, I think, in Aperon, right? Aperon? Do you know? Yes. Okay, Francisco will speak about why the Minotaur is mythology.
Grazie, Franco. What I will read should be identical to what you have in the proceedings, but already at this early point in the conference, I will find a need to interject one or two comments in response to things that have already been said in the name of dialogue. Some readers of the Phaedo have taken the Theseus myth, referred to in the dialogue's prologue, as having a function that goes well beyond its ostensible one of explaining the delay in Socrates' execution. If the delay is caused by the commemoration of Theseus' rescue of the 14 youth from the Minotaur, these readers suggest that Socrates is to be seen as the new Theseus, and that his final conversation with his followers, 14 of whom are named, in some way reenacts the rescue being commemorated. While I wish to defend this reading here, I will also argue that it has often been weakened by a misidentification of the Minotaur from which Socrates is saving his followers. The Minotaur is most often identified with the fear of death. Such an identification is certainly plausible, given Socrates' repeated efforts to allay such a fear in his followers. But the full significance of the myth for understanding the action and the message of the dialogue becomes evident only when we recognize that there's a much stronger case for identifying the Minotaur with mythology, or as it can be translated, the hatred of reasonable discourse. Only then can the myth help explain not only the crisis of faith and reasoning at the dialogue center, but also Socrates' notoriously enigmatic final words. Indeed, one could go so far as to say that it is only then that we can understand the kind of immortality truly at issue in the dialogue. The major argument for interpreting the dialogue as a reenactment of the Theseus myth must in the end be the coherence and fruitfulness of the reading such an interpretation yields. But before making the case for mythology being the key to the myth's significance, I must address arguments that have been made against even considering the myth's significance for the dialogue. This is because if some readers have seen Socrates and his 14 followers as reenacting the Theseus myth, others have challenged this. Theodor Ebert, in his commentary of the dialogue, has maintained that the reference to Theseus is sufficiently explained by the need to account for the delay between Socrates' trial and execution, and therefore should not be given any other significance. This argument, however, does not have, in my view, much force. First, the delay in Socrates' execution could simply have been left unmentioned instead of being made an explicit topic of discussion. Or it could have been mentioned without being explained. Or it could have been explained without an explicit reference to the Theseus myth, as is done at the beginning of the Crito. Of course, one could respond that Echecrates, on account of not being Athenian, requires from Phaedo a full explanation of the delay. But it is Plato's choice to frame the Phaedo with a conversation between Phaedo and a foreigner who requires this full explanation. We are, after all, not reading a transcript of a conversation that actually took place. Within the fiction, it is indeed the case that Phaedo's sole and sufficient reason for mentioning the Theseus myth is to explain the delay of Socrates' execution to someone unaware of the cause. But this tells us nothing about Plato's reason for creating a fictional conversation in which the myth would need to be mentioned. The second point is that if the Theseus myth serves to explain the delay, this obviously does not prevent it from serving other purposes. It is arguably typical of Plato's writing that a dramatic detail serving initially a rather prosaic function comes to acquire greater significance in the course of the dialogue. Think of the katabain with which the Republic begins. It would be wrong to insist that the only reason why the dialogue begins with this word katabain is that the Piraeus lies south of Athens, though this is certainly the immediate and most obvious reason. Ebert himself rather undercuts his point in noting how the Theseus myth draws attention to Socrates' special connection to Apollo. Socrates explicitly affirms his consecration to the god at 85b5, a connection Socrates, of course, shares with Theseus, since both are entrusted by Apollo with a mission of saving others. If the myth can serve this additional purpose, then why not the other one of drawing attention to how Socrates' conversation with his followers mirrors Theseus' rescue of the 14 youth? But Eggers Lahn, in his commentary on the dialogue, rejects this reading of the significance of the myth for another reason. He notes that there are not only 14 followers present in Socrates' prison cell for the final conversation. Besides the fact that Phaedo must be added to the 14 as also present, others are said at 59b9 to 10 to be present without being named. This objection is greatly weakened, however, when we recognize that it could be used to support rather than refute the interpretation in question. If many more than 14 were present in the prison with Socrates, we need to explain why Plato has Phaedo named precisely 14, neither more nor less. And what better answer could there be than that he wanted to connect, in the reader's mind, the situation in the prison cell with the Theseus myth? If then we are justified in at least asking how Socrates' conversation with the 14 named followers might mirror Theseus' rescue of the 14 youth, the answer depends on discovering in the conversation an analog to the Minotaur. As already noted, most take this analog to be the fear of death, and with some plausibility. Yet Socrates himself, at the very center of the dialogue, identifies an evil greater than the fear of death, and greater even than death itself. Indeed, he claims that there is no greater evil one could suffer than to hate logoi. Uk esten meisdon tuto kakon. If Socrates therefore seeks to save his followers from some evil, the evil is and must be the greatest evil, mythology. Socrates' comment indeed occurs in a context in which he recognizes the danger his followers are in of falling into mythology. Socrates' complex and seemingly compelling proof for the soul's immortality on the basis of the affinity between the soul and the forms, about which we have just heard, has been hit by two powerful objections on the part of Simmias and Cebes, objections from which it will not recover. So major is the crisis thereby occasioned that Echecrates must interrupt Phaedo's narrative to express his dismay and wonder. Quote, in what argument will we still be able to put our trust, Bistelsomen? For the one that was so very persuasive, the one Socrates gave, has now fallen into distrust, apistion. As Phaedo proceeds to narrate, Socrates is well aware of this loss of trust among his own followers. This crisis is central to the dialogue, both literally and figuratively, since it represents a shift from death to mythology as the major concern of the dialogue. This shift is conveyed very forcefully in a little scene occurring right after the objections of Simmias and Cebes have plunged them all into despair. Taking Phaedo's golden hair into his hands, asking him if he will cut it in mourning on the following day, and receiving a positive reply, Socrates insists that instead they should all cut their hair in mourning that very day if the argument dies and they are not able to bring it back to life. Anabiosastai. It is then that the true monster to be defeated appears, not the fear of death, but that hatred of reasonable discourse that could lead to the death of philosophy itself. It is striking and unlikely to be an accident that Plato, while not referring to the Minotaur by name in his reference to the Theseus story, though any Athenian reader would of course know that it is from the Minotaur that Theseus saved the 14 youth, should choose in naming that from which Socrates seeks to save his 14 followers a word that starts with the same letter. Mistologia thereby becomes a stand-in for Minotauros. Socrates' task for the rest of the dialogue then becomes to save his followers from this monster by bringing the argument back to life in a way that restores and strengthens his followers' trust in argumentation. This task does not require Socrates to provide a completely trustworthy proof of the soul's immortality. On the contrary, according to Socrates' diagnosis, the cause of mythology is putting too much trust in arguments, just as the cause of misanthropy is putting too much trust in people. The cure is to recognize that arguments, like people, are neither all good nor all bad, and therefore require what we could call a critical trust. Socrates' final argument for the immortality of the soul elicits precisely such a response by inspiring both trust and misgiving. It is persuasive while still leaving fundamental questions open and therefore in need of further examination. The response from Simmias this time is therefore not a knockdown objection, but rather the following, and now I quote, but indeed I too have no longer a way of not trusting hope apisto on the basis of what has been said. However, given the greatness of the topic the arguments are about and my low estimation of human weakness, I am compelled to still harbor within myself some distrust, apistia, concerning what has been said. This admittedly peculiar trusting distrust that Simmias expresses here is seen to be precisely what the doctor ordered when we take seriously Socrates' diagnosis of mythology. Phaedo, in recommencing his narrative after Echecrates' interruption, indeed notes that Socrates, with the diagnosis and cure he offered for mythology, healed them well. Eo hemas iasdato, at 89a 5-6. And this would be my response to Professor Bossi's earlier objection to this reading, which is that Socrates has not healed them, could not have healed them of mythology. I think the text says very clearly that, at least from Phaedo's perspective, Socrates has healed them of apatos. Phaedo calls it apatos. He's healed them of apatos, which Socrates proceeds to diagnose as mythology. And I think the key here, though, is to understand that the cure to mythology is not the attainment of final wisdom and virtue. The cure to mythology is, again, what I'm characterizing as this trusting distrust or distrusting trust that Simmias expresses in reaction to the final argument. The cure to mythology is not the end of the journey. It's what allows the journey to actually occur, to continue. And I think that's how the cure is to be understood here. And in that sense, the mythology that the followers are in danger of falling into has been cured. And the journey, the examination of the arguments can continue. What corresponds to Theseus saving the 14 youth from the Minotaur is Socrates curing his followers of the illness of mythology. But then, do we not have here the key to understanding Socrates' enigmatic final words, in which he claims to owe a cock to Asclepius? Since such a debt to Asclepius was normally incurred as a result of some cure for a sickness, the key to interpreting Socrates' words is identifying the sickness and the cure in his case, as we've already heard. The interpretation that has had the longest life, from the Neoplatonists to Nietzsche, as Professor Bossi pointed out this morning, and up to the present day, is, in my view, and for the same reasons that Professor Bossi gave, unsustainable. That Socrates owes thanks for escaping from the sickness of life itself is ruled out most directly by his use of the plural and by his talk of a debt that has already been incurred. We owe, he tells his fathers, a cock to Asclepius, thereby suggesting that they have all been cured already of some illness. So the question that must be asked is what this illness could be. The answer, as we have seen, is evident in the text, mythology. That is the evil Socrates describes the greatest one can suffer. That is the sickness he diagnoses in the central crisis of the dialogue. And that is the sickness of which, according to Phaedo, he has cured his followers by the end of the discussion. This interpretation of Socrates' last words, therefore, does not require tendentious speculation. And I have a little footnote here in Critique of Glenn Most as an example of tendentious speculation, again, for the same reasons that Professor Bossi offered against that reading this morning. It stares us in the face if we take the mythology passage seriously as the central point of the dialogue rather than as a mere interlude meant only to give us a break from the arguments. But if the plural we poses a problem for the traditional interpretation of Socrates' last words, does it not also pose a problem for the present interpretation? Socrates, as the speaker of these words, must include himself in the we that owe a cock to Asclepius. My reading, therefore, requires us to believe that Socrates himself was vulnerable to the danger of mythology. Indeed, in this respect, the final words echo the insistence in the retelling of the Theseus myth, that Theseus saves from the Minotaur not only his companions, but also himself. Kai autos ezote, 58b1. Can Socrates possibly have needed to save himself from mythology? Could he ever have distrusted the importance and efficacy of arguments? In his warning against mythology, Socrates not only describes it repeatedly as a danger we are subject to, but notes in particular how he himself is, at the present moment and on the present issue, in danger of becoming unphilosophical, ou philosophos ekein, and contentious, philonikos, 91a, 1-3. He does indeed immediately distinguish himself from the contentiousness of the completely uneducated, but only, he says, in this one respect, that he seeks to convince not others, but himself. The suggestion, then, is that Socrates in the present moment is understandably eager, protumesomai, to prove the immortality of the soul, and that this eagerness puts him in danger of becoming contentious. This danger has perhaps already been manifested by his attempt to charm away the fear of death by means of an argument, the affinity argument, with the serious flaws exposed by Simmias and Cebes. And this is a good connection of Harold's paper, that maybe this was serving as a mere charm and that's what they're reacting against. He explains this danger, Socrates explains this danger a little later by warning his companions that he may, in his eagerness, again, protumia, deceive both them and himself, 91c 4-5. When, therefore, Socrates suggests that rather than believe there is nothing sound or healthy in arguments, they should recognize that they are the ones who are unhealthy, hemes upoi hugios ekomen, and should fully exert themselves to become healthy, his use of the plural we is not, in my view, a matter of politeness. Socrates proceeds immediately to explain and justify his inclusion among the sick by referring to the danger he is in at the present moment. If Socrates recognizes the danger of putting too much trust in arguments we are eager to trust, he also recognized that he is not immune to this danger, especially not at the present moment when he's facing his death. His diagnosis of that sickness with respect to arguments that makes one vulnerable to mythology is a self-diagnosis. But surely, it will be objected, all this must be completely ironic. Socrates' faith in rational argumentation is unshakable, and he is utterly immune to any impulse or consideration that might interfere with or lead astray such argumentation. In maintaining this, however, we simply ignore one of the most surprising features of the dialogue's dramatic action. Socrates, we learn, has been composing poetry in prison. When asked to explain this strange behavior, he makes a surprising confession. Having in the past always interpreted a recurrent dream commanding him to practice musike as a command to practice philosophy, it being the highest musike, he now has his doubts about this interpretation. What if instead the dream had been commanding him all along to write poetry or musike of the more common sort? Just in case he was wrong, Socrates has dedicated himself in prison to writing poetry, starting with a poem to Apollo. This is because it is Apollo, through the festival commemorating the story of Theseus and the Minotaur, that has prevented Socrates from dying earlier and thus given him the opportunity to reinterpret his dream. But Socrates did not stop there. Thinking that to be a poet one must compose mutoi and not logoi, he proceeded to set into verse some fables of Aesop with the explanation that he is not a composer of mutoi himself. Furthermore, despite this last claim, Socrates at the end of the dialogue, after the arguments for immortality, composes a myth, a mutos, as he calls it, not as something to defend rigorously, but as something to recite to ourselves as an incantation. What are we to make of all of this? At the very least, the following, and there's much more I recognize that has to be said and will be said at this conference about this, but at the very least, I think we need to say the following, that Socrates has now come to suspect that composing logoi is not sufficient, that the mission on which Apollo has sent him through dreams and oracles requires him to become to some degree a poet capable of constructing fables. But why? If Socrates wants his followers to take care of and not neglect their own souls by living a life dedicated to philosophical argumentation, the diagnosis of mythology shows us that this dedication is an emotional commitment that as such is fragile and always under threat. The opposite of the hatred of logos is the love of logos, but this love can easily turn into its opposite when, overcome by fear, especially the fear of death, we eagerly put blind trust in whatever doctrine protects us from this fear. What is needed, in contrast to the traditional poetry that, as Socrates argues in the Republic, inspires only the fear of death, is a new poetry that inspires dedication to the philosophical life, so that we do not despair of the doubts that every argument must awaken. We need a poetry that gives us not a doctrine that would put an end to all argumentation, but, as Socrates calls it, a belief worth risking, a belief that will prevent us from simply giving up. What Socrates recognizes is that the logos is fragile, that it is liable to die, and that we all need a certain enchantment if we are to persevere in our dedication to it. There is thus throughout the Phaedo a very clear tension between Socrates' commitment to argumentation and the recognition that this commitment is not itself the result of an argument, but must be encouraged and fostered through a different kind of enchantment capable of appealing to the emotions. The advantage of recognizing that the Minotaur is mythology lies precisely in uncovering this tension and in showing that behind the dialogue's evident concern with mortality and the fear it occasions lies the concern with the fragility of rational discourse and the fear and despair this can occasion. In both cases, the concern cannot be dispelled by an argument, but can only be managed by a certain way of life and a certain way of relating to arguments. As already suggested, the dialogue offers a resolution to this tension between argumentation and emotional needs, and thus a cure for misology. The limitations of rational argumentation are not a problem for those who have been persuaded, enchanted to take care of their souls, and who see in rational argumentation simply a means of such care rather than a means of providing irrefutable doctrines. As Socrates explicitly concludes, he would much rather have his followers care for their souls without agreeing with the dialogue's arguments than to have them agree at the cost of stopping to care for their souls. The goal of the discussion is therefore not to prove the immortality of the soul, but to ensure that the immortality of the logos, to ensure the immortality of the logos by fostering that care of the soul that responds to arguments neither with blind trust nor with complete distrust, but rather with that trusting distrust we have seen Simmias exhibit. What Socrates asks of his followers is that they live following the tracks of what has been said now and in the past, just as Socrates would himself if he were not about to die. The dialogue emphasizes this point with the image of the sailing ship, Toploion, that plays such a central role in the Theseus myth and its commemoration. Not only must Socrates in his final argument for the soul's immortality resort to a second sailing, the Deuteros Plus, because he has failed either to discover for himself or learn from another the cause he was looking for. But in doing so, he is pursuing a suggestion Simmias made earlier in the dialogue, that failing to discover for oneself or learn from another a divine doctrine, logu teutinos, that is stable and safe, since it is either impossible or very difficult to know anything clear in this life, one must risk sailing through life on the least refutable of human logoi one can find. This is at 85D, 1 to 2. Dos dus exit lengtotaton logos. It is this second sailing that the dialogue achieves, putting together an argument for the soul's immortality that, while not easy to refute, inspires doubts and requires further examination, and risking the belief that we will be better off if we sail through life taking care of our souls by following the traces of this and other arguments. The greatest evil that is confronted and conquered in such a sailing is nothing other than mythology. The dialogue thus indeed reenacts the sailing of Theseus and the 14, and in parallel to the debt that Theseus owed to Apollo for their salvation, a debt the Athenians have paid once again during Socrates' time in prison by sending a ship to Delos, Socrates concludes his final conversation with his followers by claiming that they all owe a sacrifice to Asclepius, son of Apollo. Thank you.
We have only 10 minutes, but shortly, question.
Thank you. First thing. And then I think you have captured my fears, because I could not accept that mythology was the absolute cure because of Socrates saying, beware of this, this is not to be cured just for once and forever, but it's something we have to keep on. So thank you very much.
Something I didn't make as clear as I should have in the paper, but now after having heard your paper this morning, I'll make it clear, is that I think it is important to understand that, yes, the fight against mythology is a constant battle. I think what's happened in the dialogue is that what we have in the middle of the dialogue is a particularly bad crisis of mythology that is occasioned by this very peculiar, unique situation of Socrates' followers being confronted with his imminent death. And the cure in this case is that they've gotten through that crisis, that Socrates at least can die at the end of the dialogue knowing that his followers haven't given up on the argument, that Simmias and Lysebes, that they will continue arguing about the immortality of the soul. They will continue the investigation. So that's the cure. But you're right. What you said this morning, what you said now is right, that this he also recognizes, and he says, as you pointed out, take care of your souls, because he wants to emphasize that this is an ongoing process and not something that's just been completed once and for all.